Can everybody see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So, would you like to share any points that you remember from the last discussion that we had? Introduction to talent management. Anyone? Any point? I know it's Sunday afternoon and post lunch, difficult to remember, but anything that comes to your mind?
What I recollect is like talent management is a process wherein we attract, we retain, we develop, and I think the right people, and and we develop to the leadership level also. That would be our strategy for the talent. And it is not across the board. It is at the key positions.
Okay. Okay, great, Sonal. I think you are pretty intact in the Chennai heat. So you remember quite a bit. Okay, thank you. Manali, would you like to add?
I'm so sorry, sir, that means in last session I was not there because of some personal reasons.
Okay.
That's why this is my first session.
Oh, okay. I think Dhananjay and Vidyut also were not there, if I'm not mistaken.
Also, if I may add, now I remember, it is also about, you know, workforce planning, like also their performance management and retention and succession management. That would be a part of, you know, one of the few components of the talent management.
Right, Sonal. Now you deserve a chocolate.
Thank you.
Okay, great. So, like Sonal was saying, and, you know, like you can see in the screen in front of you, talent management is a whole gamut of activities that we do. From the stage that we plan to hire, not just hire, but plan to hire. And then how we hire, how we induct people, then how do we train people, how do we go live on production or you know, start working normally as an employee. Then how do you develop their skills further? Succession planning after that, because like we were discussing last time, and I think for Manali, for Dhananjay, for Vidyut, talent management is a very critical component of your business today. Why? Because in the service industry, as you know, that the service industry is gradually becoming a bigger part of your domestic GDP and the global GDP. So earlier, agriculture, manufacturing, these were very important, and they were a very large part of your economy. But gradually, agriculture, the number of people involved has been shrinking due to mechanization, and more people are leaving agriculture because the level of production that is required is anyway happening through mechanized agriculture, through people following more effective warehousing, supply chain, and so on and so forth. And manufacturing also, the number of people in manufacturing is getting lesser. So the contribution of services is becoming more and more important. And in services, you don't really have a product, you have a service. And who provides the service? It's the people who provide the service, okay? So therefore, what I'm trying to say is that people are becoming your product. If people are good, then the quality of your service is good. If people are not good, then the quality of your service is not good. And if your service, if the service of a service company is not good, then that service company will not survive for too long. So therefore, what talent management does really is it improves the quality of your people, and thereby it improves the quality of your service, which is also the output of your organization. So therefore, talent management is becoming more and more critical, and more people are trying to understand it. We have already been following talent management for maybe 100, 200 years. But earlier, it was not followed in a disciplined way with tools and techniques and interventions that we have now. So therefore, talent management earlier was simply a small part of HR. And it was not really something which stood out on its own. But now it is standing up and has its own independent existence and is very critical. Because if you don't do talent management right, and if you are in a software company, if you are in a banking company, if you are in a BPO company, then chances are that you will never succeed because your talent management is weak. So last time we discussed, like Sonal mentioned, we discussed various dimensions of talent management, and that's what you see over here in front of you. And at the outset, I want to clarify, you know, there are two understandings of talent management. One is that talent management is all about supporting and retaining your top talent and nothing else. And there is another school of thought which says that talent management starts from the day you decide to hire people. Okay. And it goes on through all the activities that are there subsequently. So this is the second version that we will go with today. And this is the second version, which is supported by your curriculum. Your curriculum believes in the second version. I also believe that for talent management to be comprehensive, we have to believe in the second option. Okay, so therefore, last time we did an introductory session. Today, we will look at a model of talent management. And there are no very large number of models as such. There is just one model, which is how you begin, how you close, and what you do in between. But within that process, there can be variations. Okay. And that's what we will talk about. Next time, we'll be talking about strategy. What is strategy all about? Strategy is about what are the levers you have? You know, how can you change the input, and how can therefore you change the output of what you're doing? How will you strategize to make sure that the result you are getting are the best results possible? So that's what we will talk about next time. And there will be two more sessions on how do you ensure engagement, how people are engaged or not engaged. Then we will do succession planning. And lastly, we will do a recap of what we have done. So any questions so far? I think you have been very quiet. So any questions? All clear, or it's too confusing?
Hitherto all clear.
Okay, great. Okay, so basically, you know, the process that we're talking about, the journey of talent management is you look at what is the talent that your organization needs. You know, that is where it begins. Then you know that, okay, this is what I need. Are there any further gaps in the organization that you may want to check? So you identify the gaps, and then you design an appropriate recruitment plan that, okay, these are the skills that I lack. These are the skills which I would need in larger numbers. These are the skills which are outdated and need to be updated. So then you design your recruitment plan accordingly, that this is what I need today in the organization. Actually, I had gone out for lunch, And I met my you know, my cousin's son. So he has recently done you know, electronics engineering, and he's joined a startup in Gurgaon. So I was asking him, what do you do? You know, so while he's done electronics engineering, but he's doing a lot of coding, and he's working on data analytics, you know, so things like that. Now, their organization is a startup, and basically they provide, you know, data analytics solutions and automations. So, so the organization has, if I were to look at it from a talent management perspective, they were zero till 6 months ago, and now they have about 21 employees. And all of the 21, except for probably two or three, they are all engineers, and they are, you know, engineering and you know, providing data insights to their clients, so and so forth. So now, if they are working in that area, their HR will probably, you know, as they get more contracts, their HR will look for similar skill sets, people who are engineers or people who are good at coding, people who are using Python coding language to come up with, you know, data analytics solutions and automation solutions. So it was pretty interesting to hear how this startup has grown, and, you know, it has 21 people in 6 months. And, you know, so it is getting more orders, more contracts, and therefore chances are that it will keep growing. So so they also want to have, you know, internally, they are not able to hire people, everybody who is great at computer science. So they are hiring people who have different engineering degrees also. And they are helping those people learn Python and these kind of coding languages. So their HR manager and training manager, they are both very busy trying to address these gaps that are there. And then they are creating plans for every individual who's coming in for about 2 to 3 months. They are people who do not have a computer science degree. They are taken through specialized plans, and they have individual development plans. And also, it's a startup. So the sixth point, which is have a robust succession planning mechanism. This is absolutely critical. And last time we were discussing that due to COVID, you know, a lot of people, unfortunately, were affected, and they either could not come to office, could not work, or unfortunately, they even passed away. And some of the listed companies on BSE or NSE, they had to submit, you know, to the BSE, to the SEC, that you know, so and so director has passed away, and unfortunately they did not have any talent which was ready to come and take that position. So they said, we will take another 6 months to 1 year to fill this position. So that is where succession planning comes in. Okay, so by and large, this is the process that we will be talking about. So any thoughts, any observations so far? I see Mahesh has joined us. So Mahesh, any thoughts?
Not as of now, sir. I'm just listening.
So what okay. if the HR personnel or the person who is responsible for identifying talent needs or maybe the gaps, but the organization does not have the budget for doing so? In such a scenario, what need to be done?
Okay, good question. And that is a real life situation, because you know, HR will always come and say that, okay, these are critical positions. We need to ensure that we have backups for these positions. But very often, an organization may not have the right budget.
Yeah.
So in that situation, you know, you have two alternatives. One is that you settle for maybe somebody who is not ready to take the role, but who has by and large the skill sets. And you can then train that person. You know, so you look at the gap, how much is the gap, and you can train the person. You can even have a coach for that person or somebody internally who can help guide that person to take up that responsibility. Or you look within that department and see who was closest to the role and who had the most exposure and can probably take over with the least amount of issues cropping up. So okay. Basically, what I'm saying is, you make a bad, make the best of a bad situation.
Okay.
So, but you're right, absolutely. That very often this happens, that people don't have that budget, and then you don't know, how to make sure that there is a person coming in quickly and taking over where the other person left.
And sometimes, if we have identified some people that who might take that role or maybe good enough to take that role, when the budget has not been allocated, but still in such situations also, decision being given or favoritism will be given to the line managers instead of the HR managers. The line managers give the references in such a scenario that what need to be done.
So Manali, I will not really be able to comment on that. Only thing is, I will just make an observation that the culture difference is there in organization to organization. Yeah. So in some organizations, what happens is HR is very strong, and yeah. If HR makes a recommendation, then people take it kind of absolutely accept it. But in many organizations, it is operations which is stronger, yeah. And HR and recruitment, training, quality, they are all treated as subsidiary. Because operations has this arrogance about them that, we are the breadwinners.
Sales-driven, yeah.
Sales-driven or operations-driven. But they feel that, we are the ones who are getting the money for the organization. So you keep quiet. You're a support function.
Yeah.
So that is, my experience tells me that when this second situation happens, that organization is not very mature. In a mature organization, HR is very strong, and HR follows the process, and if they recommend somebody, that would be accepted more than what is being recommended probably by the line operations. Great. Any other questions?
I was thinking in this particular scenario, like the HR taking on the in-basket exercises to identify the right person and develop, does it hold good?
Yeah, absolutely. So as I mentioned, so if we were to go to the next level of detail, you are absolutely right. We can have an assessment center, and we can be fair and, show maybe 10 persons who are likely to take on that position. So we can have a fair assessment center, we can have an in-basket exercise, we can have a group discussion, we can have an interview, we can have some role plays, and have a panel which will look at all the 10 or 5 or 6, whatever number of candidates you may have, and then this panel will take a call on who one or two of the best candidates. And that will be fair and square, because they have gone through a set of exercises, and whoever scores the best, that person will emerge. But only hitch is that very often assessment centers, development centers, these are activities which organizations don't spend too much time on. That's a very good observation, Sonal, this is something you should do. And this is something fair, this is something transparent, and this will give people more faith in the management if this sort of a thing happens.
Right, thank you.
Great. Okay, so when we are identifying talent needs, there are a couple of things that we keep in mind. So there could be new roles in the organization. Maybe the organization has decided to invest in a new business, so immediately you need new roles. Recently, I came across a company which invested and bought a company in another country. And this company they invested in, this company had HR outsourcing, they had learning and development outsourcing, and they had they had some software development. So the company which bought that company, they decided to strengthen their HR outsourcing division. And therefore, they added new roles of people who would do the business development for them. So immediately, they identified new roles. So as and when a company expands or invests in a new area, or maybe loses some talent, or maybe kind of within its business, it adds some new dimension to the business. So then new roles crop up, and you identify which are those new roles. Then new types of leadership. I was working for engineering company once, and in that company, they discovered that they were working very well, but the project managers who were handling all the projects they had, this was a very large company, and they had multiple projects going on, including Eastern Corridor, Western Corridor, Lucknow Metro, and very large projects. So, but all the interaction that was happening with the client was through the project managers. And many clients used to complain that your project managers are not good. But so we used to say that tell us with data, tell us that what data is going wrong. Is it a cost overrun? Is it a quality control issue? Is it a time overrun? Tell us. If there is no problem, then how can you say our project manager is not effective? So then something interesting came up. The client said that, he doesn't talk to us properly. He doesn't keep us updated. While work is going on, fine, we can see that. But, you need to keep us updated. We are clients after all. So we realized that the project manager was focused on the project. And the project manager was not focused on the client. The client interaction and the client handling had to be done by a new set of people. People who were, comfortable with interacting, people who had good soft skills, people who were good in communication. So we appointed some CRM managers who started interacting with the client and kept them updated. So immediately the client perception changed. The work was the same. Nothing changed. Nothing on the ground. We were doing the same hard work that we were always doing. But with this new profile coming in, there was more interaction with the client. Client was much happier. Client was now privy to every single every bit of progress that was happening in the projects. And so these new roles really helped. And time to time, you have to add new roles depending on how you understand the work that you're doing. Then you may have new skills. And again, referring to the previous example, basically, what was missing was the skill of communication, skill of interacting constantly with clients, stakeholders. So that is the skill that was missing. And we added that by bringing in these CRM managers. Then you have to understand how many people do you need. That's very critical. Like earlier, we had a question on cost. So you may want to have 10 managers, 20 managers, but you may not have a budget for that. Most large organizations, they already have budgeted positions, and you cannot ask for a position outside what is budgeted. Unless you create a business case and submit that and that gets approved. So therefore, you need to be very careful about the number of people. It should not be the result of guesswork. It should be the result of hard work. You do time and motion and see how many people do you need. Okay. So these are some aspects you need to keep in mind when you are identifying the talent needs. Then there would be gaps within your existing talent landscape, So what is it that you want? Is it, again, you want more people, new leaders, some missing skills which need to be addressed? So those are things that you need to keep in mind before you decide on your recruitment plan. Now, I don't know if any of you is in recruitment, but very often what I see recruitment people doing is that they sit with the leadership, and the leadership says that, okay, next year we will have to hire about 800 people, you know. So they say, okay, 800 people. They don't really go to the next level and understand that, okay, why 800 people? Why not 700? Why not 600? Why not 900? Why not 1,000? How did you reach 800? Then when I bifurcate the 800, if I look at skill set wise, what are the skills? You know, do we have some of this in-house? Do we have to get all of this from outside? Can't we grow people from inside? If yes, then how many? So these are questions that your recruitment team should be asking before they finalize their recruitment plan. Okay. And that will really help. That will make the plan more robust. But if you just simply say, okay, I have been asked to get 800 engineers. So here I am getting 800 engineers. Why? 800 civil engineers, tenured or freshers. If tenured, then with knowledge of which kind of software. Engineering software, beam technology, etc. So those are, you know, the granular level that we need to go down to before you have a good talent acquisition plan. Okay. So then once you have all those details in terms of cost, in terms of timeline, in terms of quality, in terms of skill set, then you decide your, you know, hiring plan. You design your hiring plan. So you look at the new ones, new roles that are there, which did not exist last year, roles which existed last year, but now people have left. So you need to fill the vacancies. So typically you have this choice. Either there are some roles which are there as a result of new business, growth in business, or people have left the organization and you need to fill those vacancies. So generally, your recruitment plan is divided into two, but then you kind of go deeper and look at various aspects of each of those. So another very important aspect is developing your internal talent. And I would say that this is the heart of talent management. How do you develop your internal talent? Okay. So this is, this also comes into learning and development. And while we will be talking about talent acquisition and employee engagement later on, but learning and development is not something that we will be talking about too much later on. So therefore, we will spend some time on learning and development. Okay. So here you start with identifying the talent. Then how do you develop the existing talent that you have, and then look at perhaps the entire process of learning and development. So I think some of you are learning and development managers, right? Anyone? All quiet. Nobody is a talented development manager?
In a very different scenario, sir, because my team, I'm taking care of the training and the development of the sales promoters, the brand promoters in the retail scenario of Himalaya Baby Care. So I am taking care of their means, enhancing their soft skills, their communication skills, and also the selling skills. So not really, but yes, some of the things I am contributing into the learning and development.
Okay, great.
Mr. Das, I head the learning and development platform for my organization.
Right, Mahesh. Great. So Mahesh, please feel free to add. Simply because I am taking this session doesn't mean I have all the answers and I have all the questions. So I'm here to learn as well from you and the rest of us. So please feel free to add. Okay.
Of course, Mr. Das. I mean, what you said was absolutely right. I mean, in my organization, whenever we raise, very, very closely working with my revenue assurance team, which is a production team.
Okay.
Every time when we go back, raise requisition to HR, we sit down. We've got a dedicated WFM team who does add value.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of why do we need this much of a headcount and where are we going to get this? I mean, both in terms of internal IJPs and an external hire.
Okay.
We hire roughly around 2,000 to 3,000 people a month. I mean, to have that much of a number on board, we only scrutinize about 20,000 profiles, and out of which we expect about 10,000 employees walking in for an interview every month. So yes, I mean, to give you an example, for last quarter, precisely, we've hired about 200 plus supervisors, which includes 30 plus trainers. And out of those 30, I had about 20 being promoted from internal management team.
Okay.
Followed by 10 external. So we've got a robust team called SEED, which is School of Employee and Engagement Development. Okay. I mean, that's part of my team, and under which we give them a 3 months of a probation where we train them how to deliver sessions in terms of designing their participants to audience and structure versus delivering a content.
Okay.
To make them a platform skill trained or TDD trained certified trainers. That's what we fundamentally do to ensure that we've got not only trainers I was talking about, but for leaders and managers, we've got a robust training plans to ensure that we internally, as in they match the criteria of when we hire people externally.
Okay, wonderful. So, Umesh, which organization do you work for?
I work with Ionagizer.
Oh, Ionagizer. Yeah,
Ionagizer IT Services. So it's a BPO in Noida.
Right. Okay, amazing. That's like, that gives us a fair idea in terms of the scale that Umesh's company has. 20,000 people screened, 2,000 hired in a month. That's amazing. And so it's obviously, I'm sure Umesh and his team, they are more rather than a team, they are probably a hiring and training engine, so to say. Really amazing. So and I'm sure similarly, software companies, I was reading somewhere, TCS will be hiring about 65,000 to 70,000 engineers this fiscal. So ITES and IT and some banking and engineering companies, they hire very large numbers, and so they have not only a small team doing training, but a very very large team kind of training and developing skills. So here, as I mentioned, that we will be talking about a little in detail about learning and development. And typically, when you talk about learning and development, there are various models that are there. We will talk about the model which I like the most. But before that, just some raw statistics. 90% of the companies, this is from a survey that was done in the US for the IT industry. So 19% hire talented people. Only 3% tend to develop people that are at entry level. And 8% retain. So this is all entry level positions I'm talking about. And 8% retain high performers and grow them. The churn is very high. Very high number of people being hired, and lesser number of people being grown and being taken to the next level. But when you're doing talent management, a couple of things before we get into a model as such is it's good to involve leaders in the talent management process. Make sure that the leaders are involved and understand what they are doing. If the business leaders, the operations leaders, the HR leaders, Mahesh mentioned WFM, if these people are involved in managing talent, then that is really helpful, because then they send out a message to the company that we are serious about retaining our talented employees. Okay. So these are some of the skills that you look for, cultural skills, financial skills, sales skills, collaboration skills. And, they should, if they are a fresher, then not. But if they have some experience, then they should have the right experience. If I am running a banking, financial service, and insurance process, then ideally I would expect the employee to have some prior experience in banking and financial services. Similarly, if I'm running a travel portal, then it's important that I hire people who have prior experience in travel industry. So so these are some skills that you know, you look for. You have multiple employee development programs, you know, leadership programs, management effectiveness programs. You have entry level programs. So very important for the company to be aligned to the possible changes that are happening. You know, earlier I gave you an example of project managers who were not able to communicate well. And then we had to get people who specialized in interacting with clients. Similarly, there are multiple software you know, changes, technological changes that are happening. There are multiple business changes that are happening. For example, the business models are changing. You know, then like in Mahesh's industry, there is a lot of you know, talk of automation. I don't know, you know, maybe Mahesh can add, but I don't know how much automation is happening, but they are saying that a lot of the voice business will move to automated platforms. Mahesh, is that correct?
It is. I mean, that's how we planning. I mean, to add it here. I mean, the businesses where we were never thought that we'll ever go to work from home model. Okay. These days are operating out of work from home. So there are a lot of businesses that we support now thinking on moving on to chatbots and speech analytics.
So
in terms of the volume that we used to get was, if in case it was 100%, so it has now already brought down to 70% because of chatbot and speech, followed by another 20% drop because of a lot of people are working, operating out of work from home model. There's another thing that I'd like to add. So there's one business which we kind of now thinking of moving on to a flex model. Flex model is something, let's say, I mean, we are 7 people here in the meeting. So we, all of us are trained. It's basis the requirement. So let's say if I say, I mean, it, the way we have fleet services like Ola and Uber, every time I switch on saying that now I'm ready to take the booking, I switch on my device. It's the same way we designing these flex people, which mean anytime they'll come back and say, now I'm ready to take call, I'll just switch on my cell phone and say that now I'm ready to take call, and calls will start landing in. But that's the kind of automation that we probably now thinking of developing for our clients, which will help in term of a manpower, as in readily available anytime and every time. So let's say you have a high call volume specifically on XYZ day for XYZ reasons. You can always enable people to start taking those calls in terms of a voice, chat, email, or any other support that we do.
Okay, wow, wonderful. So so changes, you know, as you can kind of sense from what Mahesh is saying, that changes are happening real time, right across the spectrum, you know, whichever industry we may be in. So particularly now, due to COVID and due to all the challenges that have come up, even more changes are happening than probably would have been happening otherwise. So therefore, your employee development program has to be completely aligned to the challenges and to the changes that are happening. You know, so therefore, the role of technology cannot be, you know, stressed more. It is absolutely critical, and technology is becoming more and more decisive in the kind of business model that you have, in the kind of you know, employee development programs that you have, what kind of development you want to do. All of that is greatly influenced by the kind of technology that is available. Okay, so and that also ensures that you stay ahead of competition. Okay, I was speaking to somebody, and you know, so like Mahesh was talking about work from home. So they have created this app, and this app is available on the phone. So all the employees are working from home, and they're logged in through the app. And you know, most of the work is getting distributed through the app, and they are, even if they have to go on the field, they may not have to come to the office, but sometimes they have to go on the field. the app is active and the app is always telling them, do this, you know, go to so-and-so customer, pick up so-and-so documents, or you know, meet XYZ. This is what you need to communicate to them, stuff like that. So there is a lot of things. So first of all, people had to be trained on it. People had to be made ready to be constantly at home or on the field and not in the office. So all of that took some time. And all the training happened through a virtual platform, you know, through Microsoft Teams. And people were trained. And then, so that is helping that organization stay ahead of competition and, you know, do things which are different and far more faster, making them more agile as an organization. And the fourth point is very critical. People should not, as a result of the changes that are happening, feel dissatisfied or unhappy. And if they are, then there are consequences on the quality of work that gets generated. And I was mentioning earlier that we are in the service industry and you don't have any products other than the people who work for you. So if the people are happy, then a happy employee results in a happy customer. If the people are not happy, then you will get unhappy customers. So therefore, people should be satisfied. People should have a sense of belonging. People should have a sense of engagement. And if they are happy, if they are engaged, if they have a sense of belonging, then their productivity will also be more. So those are some very important dimensions that you keep in mind when you create a training intervention or a learning and development strategy. Okay. So, okay. And last is attracting talent goes without saying. If you have the right talent, you are in the game. If you don't have the right talent, then sorry, you have already lost before the competition has started. Okay, so those are things you need to keep in mind. So I will just quickly share a model called the 6D model of L&D. Learning and development has various models. One of the most famous ones is known as ADDIE. ADDIE stands for Analyze, Design, Develop, Implement, Evaluate. And that is a development model of learning. It is like your software development lifecycle. You know, it has a beginning and a closure with the implementation. But of late, you know, there have been more models coming up, and I particularly like this model, and I will explain why. This is known as it's come from a book called Six Disciplines of Learning, and it is known as the 6D model. So what it entails is basically, first of all, D1, it defines the business outcome. So if you notice, you know, most like ID talks about analysis, whereas here they talk about, first of all, start with the end in mind. You know, like Stephen Covey says that start with the end in mind. Do not start, okay, here is a starting point, but what is it that you wish to achieve with this? You know, you should be clear about that. If you are clear about the end goal, then you know how to start, what to do, how much to invest, whom to depend on, all that becomes clear. So therefore, it's very important that you have the end in mind. What is it that you are trying to achieve? What is the business goal you wish to secure? Okay, so define the business outcomes. I want to, as a result of this training, I want to increase sales. You know, like Manali would be saying that I want to increase sales, or, you know, I want to increase customer satisfaction, or I want to increase the retention of people in the company. So whatever your business outcome is, it's good, first of all, to define it. Then understand the complete learning and development experience. You know, will it start with a training program? Will it start with a virtual platform interaction? Will it start with an email which will go out to participants? Will it start with, you know, some recognition at work? So how will you define the set of experiences? You know, what is the training going to be? Is there going to be a single intervention? Is there going to be multiple interventions? You know, all of that. So the entire training design, the experience, you know, what are the set of experiences people will have? So that needs to be clear. Then you deliver for application. So I will not say that, okay, now let's learn Python. Okay, have you understood Python? Okay, wonderful. So everybody now knows Python. Okay, now let's go and learn C++. Now let's go and learn Visual Basic. No, I will learn what I really need to apply today. So if I need to apply Python language, then I will learn Python and I will apply it. So basically, focus on learning which can be applied and not something which is good for my general knowledge. You know, I'm not here to improve my general knowledge. I'm here to improve my execution skills. Okay? So therefore, deliver for application. Then drive learning transfer. This is a very critical part. You know, so we have a trainer. We have e-modules. We have, videos. We have so many things. But are people listening? Or are they focused on their WhatsApp? And if people are listening, then can you test them and find out that have they really understood? It's not enough to just listen. Can they apply that? Okay. So therefore, if they can apply, if they can implement, then that means the learning transfer has happened. Okay. And then you deploy performance support. So this is, what does performance support mean? Anybody? Anybody would like to guess what performance support means? Any guesses? I think Sonal has already earned a chocolate. Who else would like to earn a chocolate? Okay, so let me eat my own chocolate. So performance support is basically all the tools, techniques, the handouts. For example, I have learned something new and I get a desk calendar which kind of reiterates what I have learned today, what I have learned. So it has all that is mentioned over there. For example, I used to work in a manufacturing company where everybody, when you went to the shop floor, when you went to the factory, everybody knew like what is welding, what is scaffolding. So these were all basic engineering skills. But along with that, even though they knew it and they were all engineers, but still on every wall, you had all these diagrams telling you and reinforcing the information that when you are welding, take these precautions. When you are, constructing some material, this is, how you should be dressed. This is what you should have industrial glasses on your face. You should not just come here without those glasses. So, there are lots of tips and tricks. These are a lot of handouts, which are very critical. And they become even more critical when you think of on-the-job training. So on-the-job training is probably the largest part of training that happens. Though, unfortunately, we don't give it that recognition it deserves. But on-the-job training, you need to have all these handouts, these, DIY documents so that they know what are the steps to be followed, how is it to be followed, what precautions are to be taken, all of that. And last but not the least, you document the results. So you say that, okay, before I started training, this team was scoring maybe 60% on customer satisfaction. After my training, they are scoring 75%. So there is a increase of about 15%. So that's good. So my training is pretty effective, and then you will probably devise methods of retaining that knowledge. So define business outcomes. Basically, you need to start with the end in mind and, what is it that the business is trying to accomplish? Then you design the complete learning experience. So what is the concept? How do you break it up? How will people learn? What activities will they do? What role plays will they do? Things like that. And then you apply, as I mentioned, you deliver for application. Drive learning transfer. This is, as I mentioned, that this is absolutely critical. Can the learners, whatever they learned in the training environment, can they go to the work environment and implement all of that. So, you know, this is very, very critical, the transfer phase. Then you have deploy performance support, you know, closely aligned with learning transfer is having the performance support to sustain innovation. And very least, this means that learners have the support of their manager. They have job aids. They have performance support tools. They receive coaching. So these are very critical. And lastly, you should document the results. So unfortunately, what happens very often in training is that we don't document what has happened. You know, the outcome, the business outcome, the improvement that it has brought about, that is not well documented. So that is something that we should do more of. So any questions on this 6D model? Any thoughts, any observations? Is it good, bad, ugly?
This is definitely good, Mr. Das.
Great.
Sir, this is Dhananjay here. So can you just share the previous two slides with the point D3?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you,
sir. Okay, well. So, so basically, you know, so that's the heart of learning and development, that these are some of the things. Of course, every topic is very large and, you know, cannot be kind of encapsulated within an hour or two. But by and large, these are some of the key things that we should do in learning and development. And this model helps us, you know, learn that. So, so I will move now from learning and development. And so another part of learning only, which is the IDPs or individual development plans. And why IDP is because when you have individual development plan for your employees, and some companies do this very diligently, some don't, some do it half-heartedly. And while they have a default development plan for everybody at a certain level. So if like somebody is operations assistant manager, then they have a standard IDP for the system manager in operations. Similarly, they have a standard IDP for a manager in you know, HR or training or whoever. But in some cases, the plans are actually customized for that particular individual. So when you are designing a IDP, you know, focus on what is the strength that people have. Why strength? Because see, very often what happens is we keep focusing on what is the gap that you have to bridge. What is the shortcoming or the lack that this person has? This person maybe is not very good in making a PowerPoint presentation, is not very good in interacting with clients, but is very good in managing his team, is very good in you know, Excel sheets. But we keep focusing on not what the person is good on, but what the person lacks. Now, there is a, you know, entire philosophy based on you know, based on a book called The Strengths Finder. So there, I'm forgetting the name of a particular psychologist, but basically what he said was that you have to focus on strengthening your strengths, not on overcoming your weaknesses. Please be aware of your weakness, you know, and don't allow it to hamper your career, but you can really grow by strengthening your strengths, you know. So therefore, when you're designing an IDP, it's important to understand the strengths that every individual carries. And therefore, you should ensure that that strength is taken to the next level or the level that is required by the business. So then you also look at development areas. As I mentioned, that the gaps also need to be identified, because you know, that is those gaps can be very severe. Like suppose somebody is into client interaction and the person doesn't know how to make even one slide on PowerPoint. So that's a big disadvantage, you know, and the person has to learn. Similarly, let's say a person has a very large team, but the person has a temper problem, you know, so the person has to address that problem. Otherwise, the person cannot carry on leading a very large team. So therefore, the development areas have to be identified and have to be addressed. I know a person who was brilliant as a leader, you know, who was very good with numbers, who had a lot of business acumen, who kept growing his business, you know, from one level to another. But there was a small problem. He was from a very small town, and he was not very polished. So sometimes he would actually even say very unpleasant things to people on their face and in front of, you know, 20, 30 people. So people felt that while he's very good as a business leader, but there is one shortcoming, is his interpersonal skills, which is not very good. So therefore, he was sent on a global assignment, and where he would interact with some of the senior people in Europe, and it was expected that he would improve significantly. But after 1 year, it was seen that, you know, instead of improving, we got complaints about his behavior even in Europe. And so what was realized is that therefore he needed some more grooming and coaching, rather than just allowing him to go to a new environment and expect that he will change overnight. So that did not happen. But so eventually he was coached, he was given feedback, and he improved enormously. So therefore, when you're developing the individual development plan, you have to understand what are the strengths of this individual and what are the areas where this person needs to improve. Then, what is the experience the person has had so far, and what is the experience that you can ensure through training, through peer interaction, through exposure to certain kinds of projects. You know, all of those things can be thought of. In some companies, they align you to a program for 1 year, 2 years, you know, and you learn various things in that program. In one company where I worked, they had a FMP, financial management program. And in that, you moved from, let's say, general ledger to accounts receivable, accounts payable, you know, all kinds of financial planning tools. So, and all kinds of financial planning experiences. So after 2 years, this person came out as a very experienced professional as compared to what he or she was when they joined the program. Okay. So those are certain things which you look for when you design a IDP or individual development plan. Okay. So you try to address the skill gaps, look at the past experiences, including training, as I mentioned, coaching, and OJT. So last but not the least is succession planning. As I mentioned, that this is very, very critical. This is like emergency planning. You know, what will happen in an emergency, you should be ready for that. And that's what good business is all about. You know, businesses which are not mature, they don't have succession planning. But businesses which are mature, they have succession planning. And they ensure that these plans are robust, they're realistic, and they factor in the ground realities. So typically, it is meant for senior leadership. It is not meant for everybody. Key roles and senior leadership. At times, middle management, but not always. Okay. And particularly, these are for positions which require unique skills, you know. So it could be your IT guy, you know. It could be strategic quality. It could be strategic finance. So there are some unique roles which need business continuity, and therefore you have to ensure that there is a good succession plan that is there for these positions, and positions requiring specific knowledge. So this is again very, very important, specific kind of knowledge. So in some software companies, you know, there are niche software areas where only very few people understand those technologies. So people who have that knowledge, they may not grow vertically, but they are always given good increments. They are given growth, even though their team size may not grow, but they are typically considered a functional track, and they are given growth, for their number of years and increasing experience. So, you know, those are a couple of things which you need to ensure when you are doing succession planning. So, who are your employees whom you consider as successors? You look at their strengths, their, you know, so development areas and applicable experience. So now here we have a tool, which is a succession planning tool. It's a very simple tool. Let me just open it. Can you see my screen?
No, sir, it's blank.
Okay, just give me a minute. Can you see it now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
It's not very clear. Yeah, no, it's better. It's better.
Okay, so now you can see that this is a very simple template, and what it talks about is the key leadership roles or critical positions or people who have specialized knowledge. You need to mention that on the column in the left. Then the location, you know, who's the person who's currently handling this responsibility, you know, is you know, the replacement ready, or if not, then how much time will it take? 6 months to 12 months, 1 year to 2 years, 2 to 3 years. So whatever it is, but so you kind of, you know, it's a very basic template, and you kind of create a list of these positions, and then you say what is the duration during which they are going to be ready. There could also be an additional detailing, which is if you want to do some additional interventions for them. You know, in some companies, what happens is that, let's say you are going to be promoted to being a manager, but they will not promote you to be a being a manager before they have already given you exposure of working as a manager. You know, let's say you are a deputy manager, but you are given responsibility of a team and you are already operating like a manager. And when they see you working like that for some time, 6 months, 1 year, then they promote. So, you know, so that is something which is a succession plan, work in progress, which is actually a very good thing. But sometimes it is frustrating for the person who's working. They feel that I'm already working as a manager. Why can't I be recognized as well? It's just that the organization is careful and doesn't want to rush in, you know, doing that. Okay. So that's a simple template for this. And I will go back to our presentation. Now, I want to share important tool, which is basically a talent management tool. This is the 9-box grid, and we will you know, in the next session we will look at it in more detail, but I just want to give you a sense of this tool.
So this tool also been used in the performance management system to evaluate
Absolutely.
The competencies and skills.
Absolutely. You're right. So, so this is basically a 9-box grid, you know, and it divides people into potential and performance into 3 levels: high potential people, middle potential, and low potential. And then similarly, performance also is divided into does not meet expectations, meet expectation, and exceed expectation. And So while I will not spend too much time today into all these boxes, but basically in the top right box, you know, you have people who are, you can see this box, you can see my cursor, people who are high potential, at the same time, people who are exceeding expectations. So that means from a potential standpoint and from a performance standpoint, these people are the best. So this is also known as the inverted L. You know, you can see this is a L, but this is an inverted L. So this is your top talent. And people who are high on potential and high on performance, very often what happens is people who are high on performance, they may or may not have very high potential to grow to the next level. And there are some people who have high potential, but they don't translate their potential into performance. But people who are doing that, you know, so they are the people who are your go-to persons, people who are ready to take up bigger responsibilities. And therefore, it is this people that you need to ensure that they are on a learning track, they are on a fast track, and they have, I used to work in GE, and there minimum you had to spend about 3 years in any role, okay, before you got a promotion. But there were some people who were known as the fast trackers, and they could be considered for a role after 18 months because they were typically in the inverted L. They were high on potential and high on performance. There was one more criteria which they evaluated on, which many companies don't, but they also evaluated people on values. Okay, so it was potential, performance, and values. At least those days, values was more critical than performance, more critical than potential. Jack Welch, who was the CEO of the company, the legendary CEO, he used to say, I will use his words. So please, he used to use words which are not politically correct or not the best of words, but these were his statements. I will repeat it verbatim. So he used to say, if somebody has got the numbers, if somebody's got the value but ain't got the numbers, then he's fine. Give him another chance. But if somebody's got the numbers and he's got the values, then embrace him, love him. And if somebody has got the numbers, which means performance and potential, so somebody has got the numbers but ain't got the values, he's the horse's ass, throw him out, which means just if he doesn't have the right values, he may be getting the numbers, he may be getting your growth, but he doesn't have the right values, then we don't want him, so throw him out. So that's what the philosophy was at that time. But generally, a nine blocker talks about two axes, performance and potential. And anybody who's in the top right box, then that person is considered high on performance, high on potential, and that person also happens to be your top talent. Is it making sense?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So this is, we will go a bit deeper into each of these boxes, and you can actually, this is a very simple no-brainer tool, and you can just keep it with you as an HR person, and you can actually plot your team in this. I have to use this very effectively just to understand my team and where I want to see, how I want to grow people, how I want to position them. So I have, used this very effectively. Recognize the best in my team, to help the people who are the second best, and also make sure that people who are not performing, are they not performing because of incapability or due to lack of interest? So, and both of them have solutions, whether it is incapability or lack of interest, but lack of interest, you can drive only to an extent. After that, you have to let go of them, because if they are not interested, then, we are adults. We don't really have that much time to get people to be interested. Motivation has to be intrinsic or internal, So a manager can do XYZ. The organization can do XYZ. But even after that, if somebody is not shaping up, then, you have to plan an exit strategy. Okay, so that's by and large, what I wanted to cover today in terms of a generic talent management model. But I have a small exercise for you, which I would want all of us to do as a group. Okay. So now, so this is a small case which you need to understand and then share your thoughts. You know, I will give you about 5 minutes to discuss amongst yourself, and then somebody can join on the things that we should be doing. So, Sonal, would you like to read the first two paragraphs?
Right, sir. A major hospital in the US state of Georgia called Health Hub had a reputation which had spread beyond the borders of the state. It was modern, however, not state of the art. It was expensive, but the services were fairly good, however, not exceptional. It was learned that a major chain of hospitals, Columbus, known globally, had decided to set up a state of the art hospital very close to Health Hub. Initially, it would have only half the number of beds as Health Hub, but would add capacity down the next 1 year. Its services would be priced similarly, but would offer the best in class diagnostics and treatment.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Mahesh, would you like to read the next paragraph? Next two paragraphs?
Sure. Health Hub was concerned that employees would leave once the new hospital began built nearly open its door. It commenced workforce planning and decided to hire an HR consultant to devise a talent development model, which would help in hospital retain its talent. You are the HR consultant. Please help develop a talent development model, which will help the hospital steam the loose of talent.
Thanks. So basically, as you can make out, there is this hospital called Health Hub, and they are going fine. They charge a lot of money. They are not very good, but they charge a lot of money. They are just about okay. Now, this new chain is coming in the neighborhood, and this is a global chain. So they have very good technology. They have, very good services, and their pricing is similar to Health Hub, though their service quality is much better. Now, obviously, Health Hub is facing a crisis that soon this hospital will come, and what will happen? Most of our people will probably leave or try to leave. So what do we do to ensure that it is not just having a retention strategy, but you need to think of an entire talent management strategy, okay, which will help Health Hub retain its talent and compete with Columbus. Because if their doctors, nurses, paramedical staff, all of them go away, as I was saying, in the service industry, it is the people who make a difference. And if the doctors and nurses go away, then what will they do? And obviously, when Columbus comes in, it will not bring doctors and nurses and paramedicals along with them. They will obviously hire from the local area only. So therefore, this old hospital Health Hub has a big problem now. So now I want you to discuss internally between each other and take 5 minutes, discuss and then jot down what are the key things Health Hub should be doing. Okay, I will keep quiet. I'm just stepping aside for 5 minutes. You discuss amongst yourself and I will come back, and then you can tell me your recommendations. Is that clear? Is that okay? Is that okay, everyone?
Yes, pretty much.
Okay, great. So all yours, please go ahead. And then I will talk to you again 5 minutes later. If you want some more time, you can tell me, and we can take it from there. All the best. Over to you. So Mahesh and Sonal, you can lead the discussion, and you know, others will join in as well.
Sure. So Sonal, as per you, what do you think we should do?
Yeah, so here they are saying, as I mean, portraying as the HR consultant, I need to develop a talent development model. So there is a loss of there should not be loss of talent. So first, you know, who would try to go to Columbus from Health Hub? I need to, you know, have a survey kind of thing and understand the job satisfaction, because people who are satisfied with the present job, they would not think of switching over. But those who are dissatisfied would be the first ones to just switch on to the Columbus. So I think I'll
disagree to this point, Sonal, knowing Columbus being in Columbus being in global brand, global change, everybody would, I mean, so it's like, let's say if somebody is given an opportunity, or TCS or all big fours, which is like EY's, TCS, Deloitte's, they open door saying that everybody is welcome. So if whether you are happily working, you're not happily working, you'll probably tend to find a option moving in there. Because if Tata, for that matter, today say that we are opening doors for anybody and everybody, irrespective of the experience and education that you bring into the table, we'll get you a job. Everybody would like to go there, because you tend to kind of get a job security. I mean, while you're satisfied with your company, but then looking at the pandemic 2019 and now, you open an environment where you get to see a job security, and everybody would like to move in there. And Columbus being Columbus, Asia specifically being the biggest brand in the chain of hospitals, everybody would like to move on. Having said that, yes, people who would kind of not happy will definitely move forward first.
And those who have this values of loyalty and integrity towards the organization may not shift at all. That's my take, firstly. So that's why I said we need to identify those who are dissatisfied with the job.
Okay. Manali, anything that you'd like to add?
This is Dhananjay here. What I would like to say is, you know, we would convert the hospital into a state-of-the-art hospital. That should be the first step that Health Hub should take up.
Okay. Vidyut? Manali?
It's not necessary that all the people will be switching over. We also need to develop something which attracts the talent, and so that they should not reach their current job and moving to the Columbus. So we need to find out such a model in which both means the Health Hub as a hospital is getting in the form of services from the talent whom we can develop, so that they should not be switching over to Columbus. Because in one of the strategies, like if they will be serving for such and such period, then they will be getting the additional education or something which would be helpful for them in a longer run. So something like that can also be done.
I think what I'd like to take it forward, this from an real life example, I'll do an EWS, which is early warning system. As a HR consultant, I try and sit with everybody. I'll try and understand what is that they're up to and how is that they're looking at, whether this they're happy, not happy, and what is the kind of suggestions that they bring onto the table, if in case we'd like to make this as a regional setup to a world-class health facility. When you do a one-on-one, and then when you probably do skip levels, you generally tend to find out a lot that you don't know what's happening under your nose. Basis that, you can design a pool, which is, I mean, precisely that we were looking at nine dots, which are your high potential and high people versus people who are very, very low on development or potential. And then you can define a a talent development model as to how to take it forward, who to be trained, what to be trained, because you have to show them a growth path as to if in case they continue to stick back for next 3-5 years with the organization, what is that they're going to get. That's definitely going to be important. Likewise, when we undergo a lot of speeches as to what is the manifesto going forward for an organization. So basis that you can design a complete plan and a model is what I feel.
So absolutely. So once we identify the key positions, we need to develop them and have strategies in place to retain them, come what may.
Of course. Would you like to add something? Manali, any other point?
I think you have covered all the points. But SWOT analysis can also pretend at what are the strengths and what are the weaknesses and opportunities and threats, considering the talent which is available and how how we provide them growth so that they should not be switching over to the other opportunities that you have already included. So I think it's quite clear.
One point I would like to add is, when we were just in the previous slides, it was talking about the employee development program, which also includes, you know, the company embracing the change. So, keeping up with the pace with the latest technology and staying ahead with the competition is required, because how long can you just, you know, have strategies to retain them, but you have to match up with the competition. So, understanding and embracing the technology and helping the health hub needs to change with the time. I think that's all we have, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, hi, I'm back. Okay, so have you decided the steps that should be taken by Health Hub? Yes, no, maybe?
Yes, we have. And Mahesh is going to sum it up on.
Okay, great. So,
if I may request, Mahesh.
Okay.
You can take it forward. I'm just actually on an office call, which is apparently urgent. Mr. Das, I'm so sorry.
No problem. Okay, so over to you.
So there were a few points which starts with identifying the key positions wherein we require the talent to be retained, and having interventions or strategies to retain and develop them. Because there would be few employees who would be dissatisfied. So Mahesh had the input that we, as an HR consultant, we should be speaking to them one-to-one and understand what's happening on the ground, and then identify who are the dissatisfied ones and taking account of the situation on the ground.
Okay.
So, because everyone with Columbus coming into the competition, everyone would not go, but there would be many with the better salary structure. Many would like to go, but if we identify the key positions and we have definite and structured strategies to retain them, so we can hold them back. Second point was given by Dhananjay, that we need to embrace the technology. The latest, we should help the company to keep up with the change and embrace the latest technology and stay ahead with the competition.
Okay. Sorry, just say this again.
Yeah, it was basically, you know, since Columbus is at upper hand because of the latest technology and the equipment, so Columbus, besides identifying the key positions and retaining them, they should also move ahead with the and stay ahead with the competition and embracing the latest technology for the change. And Manali, am I missing out on anything? You may please add.
I think, Sonal, we more or less covered everything. Right. So, yes, Mr. Das, the point was probably knowing that Columbus being a global change, anybody and everybody will be probably looking out for an option, thinking it's a commendable opportunity. So, as a consultant, I think doing a skip level, which will define the nine dots specifically in terms of potential and less potential employees. Basis that adding some world-class technologies and getting people trained so that that adds to their candidature and the profile for a futuristic aspect, giving them what organization can take it forward in next 2-5 years offline as a manifesto, and then developing them, nurturing them, thinking that if in case somebody from a top management moves out, who's going to take the next point forward, and then developing them accordingly is the plan that we thought.
Okay, good. So yes, I think Health Hub needs to do a couple of things. One is use the nine blocker tool to identify who are the top talents and ensure that those top talent people have a individual development plan which is detailed, which creates a very strong bond for them to stay in the company. For example, the plan may say that if in 18 months, in the 18th month, we will send you to a top business school to get a certification in HR management or on operations management or something like that. So you will get this degree, which is in line with should be in line with what the person wants to learn. So first of all, to identify who are the top talents. Second is among them, who are those people who are at risk who may want to leave. Then address, like we were talking about, the individual development plan, that see what is what does this person wants to learn. For example, IT people, you would have seen that typically they have a desire to get many certifications, a Microsoft certification, Oracle certification, things like that. So let's say this one of your top talents is an IT guy and you don't want him to lose him to Columbus. So you say that, this is what I will be investing in your learning, in your growth. Next, you may want to, take a small selection of these guys and maybe want to explore promotions for some of them, but not immediately. If you continue in our organization, for X number of months or years, then this is the growth that we have in mind for you. And communicate that upfront. If you communicate that upfront, then the person has reasons to stay in the organization. Then if even he gets an offer, he will think, no, here I'm getting promotion, growth, increment, while, they are giving me 10 to 20% hike. And then what? I don't know whether they will, ensure growth for me, whether they will invest in my learning or not. So basically, all the elements which we talked about in terms of, their learning path, in terms of motivating them to see a bigger, longer future with Health Hub and things like that. In some companies, they also have something called a deferred income plan, which is that if you stay with that organization for 2 years, I will give you X amount of money, as an additional payout. And probably Health Hub could do that also.
So, exactly, Mr. Das. I was about to say this. There's something called retention bonus. Right. Which probably you can give it to people that over a in installment for the next 5 years, this is what you're going to get.
Exactly. So that helps you to retain those people. And also, look at when we talked about fast tracking. So you may want to fast track some of your top talents so that they are able to see the growth in the next 18 months, 36 months, 5 years, etc. So those are certain things which you can do, particularly for the people who are critical to your organization. You may not want to do it for everyone. Of course, you may also try to sign a no poaching deal with Columbus, but chances are Columbus will not agree to it because they are new and they want to attract talent. So they may not want to do that. In that case, you may strategically want to let go of your bottom talent, that these people are not very effective, they are not doing very well. Maybe they can go to Columbus and harm overall Columbus' performance. So that can also be done. That is a strategic thing to do, but people may want to think on those lines also. Yes, so by and large, that's how things would shape up. But yes, people need to feel they are invested in. People need to feel that the organization cares for them. And people need to feel that there is a learning path defined in front of them for the next 12 months to 24 months to 36 months. Then people feel reassured. So that makes a big difference. Okay, so that brings me to the close of today's session. So any thoughts, any observations, any questions? Sonali, anything from your end?
No, it's a very productive discussion and everything was included into it and different thoughts were brought while discussing the case. So it was a very good session to learn from peers and...
Great. Okay, then we will close for the day and have a great evening. Thanks, Dhananjay. So have a great evening and we will meet same time, same place, as TV anchors say.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Take care. Bye.
Bye.
Mr. Dad, you take care. Thank you, everyone.
Bye.